statewide organization, and with a mission of catalyzing change and empowering communities. Catalyzing change and empowering communities. And we do that in a number of ways. And one way we do it is through organizing. And tonight is a step in that direction. We want to do meetings like this around the state on a regular basis. We had one on Hawaii a couple weeks ago. We'll be on Maui next week. And we'll be in Hilo the following week. And we plan on ultimately having at least two, if not quarterly meetings, gatherings like this in every county throughout the year. And the objective is to meet and organize together and interact socially, like we're doing a little bit now. But it's also to communicate and educate each other on what's going on. So we'll be having speakers like we're having tonight on every one of these meetings. HAPA is a, we're focusing on four, maybe actually five different subject matter areas. The one we started on, and you'll hear a little bit tonight, is about pesticides, GMO, and agriculture. So that's one subject matter area, that's what we started on. That's what a lot of you might be interested in. We're gonna talk about that tonight. But we're also looking at income inequality. We're looking at what we can do on a statewide level to help raise people out of poverty, what tools we can provide, what actions we can do. I spent some time today driving around Kaka'ako, and it's just, it never ceases to blow me away at the condition of those homeless or shelterless people that live out there. And we there's much more we need to do as a state and as a nonprofit organization and as a community on those issues. We're also dealing with cultural and environmental stewardship. Walter Ritte, who's on our board, is going to speak to those issues in a second. We're also doing work in civic engagement. We're looking at identifying, recruiting, and training emerging leaders to be ready for the 2016 elections. We think that's a fundamental need in our community, to in every county, at every level. We need to reach out, identify, train, and support new leaders who could serve us in public office. We're looking at other projects as well, but those are a few of the things we're working on. We have some of our board members here today. Bart Dane. Bart is standing in the back. Bart, raise your hand, please. Thank you, Bart. Karen Shisedo is back here. Karen, thank you. Kate Watanabe. Kate, are you still here? Kate Watanabe is with Local 5, is on our board of directors. We have a very diverse board, again, on every island and covering many, many subject areas. And so if I invite you to reach out to me or any board member, but myself specifically, if you have questions, I'm easy to find, you can email me, go to our website. Today we're gonna go through the program. We're gonna have Uncle Walter Ritte speak for a little bit. And then we have a special guest, a very special guest. Well, we're all special guests today. But we have Kyle Smith. Kyle, where are you? Kyle's here, thank you, Kyle. Kyle's an attorney who just won on behalf of the residents of Waimea Valley, a landmark lawsuit against DuPont Pioneer. And a lot more work to do on it, but he won the first round, and we're very pleased to have him here to talk a little bit about that. And then I'm gonna talk a little bit about the pesticide, agriculture, GMO kind of subject matter, focusing on a trip that a small delegation from Kauai just took to Switzerland. So without further ado, we'll introduce Uncle Walter Ritte to give us his whatever monomo he wants to share with us. Thank you, Walter.
Aloha, Kako.
Aloha.
I'm going to talk a little bit, and what I really wanted to do was to get some questions coming out of the audience, because sometimes I'm driving a truck down this side, but everybody wanted to go down that side. So we'll give an opportunity for you to kind of steer the discussion a little bit later. Right now, I'm part of many, many different groups. And the reason I'm part of many, many different groups is because there are many, many different groups out there. And everybody's got their own idea about where they're going to go and how they're going to get there. And a lot of times there's conflicts between the groups. Even though we're heading for the same area, same target, there's always conflicts. So I've been asked many times exactly what group do you represent, and I say I don't really represent any group, but I'm part of a lot of different groups, and HAPA is one of those groups. HAPA is sort of a newer group, and it's different from some of the other groups that I'm involved with. I'm involved with all kinds of different groups, some really grassroots, and some that needs a lot of people and a lot of technology in order for them to operate. And sometimes it's good, when you have a very complicated group, it's like trying to steer an aircraft carrier in a wall, and when you need a speedboat. So sometimes you need those little speedboats to drive those guys crazy while you get the aircraft carrier out on the side and just runs over everybody. So I like the idea of having all of these different groups. The trick now is to try and figure out how to get all these different groups together.
Right.
So everybody understands that dilemma. Easy to say, hard to do. So it's starting to work though. When I first started getting involved in communities, it was because of an island called Kaho'olawe. And that was not anything that I had planned. It just happened. And out of that came an involvement in the community. And I did get involved in all kinds of stuff, and I'm still involved in all kinds of stuff. The other big event that I was surprised to be involved with was GMOs. And that was because the University of Hawaii decided that they were going to GMO the Hawaiian taro. And then, to make matters worse, they decided they were going to patent the thing and claim ownership. And then they were going to sell the seeds and the huli back to us. So that was like, whoa. So that got me involved in GMOs. And the problem with getting involved with GMOs was that when we became involved, I found myself like one of three or four Hawaiians with about 100, 200 haoles in the room. So the GMO started to get a bad rap, especially on the island of Maui, when we started doing some organizing on Maui. That's when I first really got organized with GMO stuff was on Maui. And the council people, we were there testifying, and after all the testimony, I would hear them talking. And you know, they would say things like, wow, these guys just off the boat and they're here to tell us what's good for us. Who the hell do they think they are? Then when I'm on a street waving signs for GMOs, they're yelling at me, go back to America where you came from. You know, so I knew something was wrong with this whole picture. So today we find ourselves getting more and more local people and Hawaiians waking up to the fact that it's not only you getting poisoned by food, but they're poisoning your land. And that's the thing that got Hawaiians more and more involved. Yes, you had no right to own our town. Yes, you had no right to modify our town. But you are not going to poison our lands. So that's what's happening now in the Hawaiian community. There's a gradual shift towards exactly what you're eating, whether it's good or bad, or whether it's legal or non-legal, to the fact that our lands are being poisoned. And for us as Hawaiians, we have that kuleana, that responsibility to protect that land and hand it to the next generation in a better shape than we found it. That's something that we all have kuleana towards. So that is going on. So on the other side of the fence, when I talk to the Haoles, and I talk to them about sovereignty, a picture goes in their head that we're all dala dala, the Hawaiians are all dala dala, they're going to buy them a one-way ticket back to the mainland. And, you know, it freaks them out. This whole idea of Hawaiian sovereignty freaks them out, that somehow it's something bad. So I'm trying to go around and explain to the two sides that we're all on one canoe here, and that if we don't come together, both of us are gonna lose. And it's simple politics. One and one is two. And if you got three guys, the two guys lose. So it's not very complicated. So the idea when I'm talking to Hawaiians, is that number one, we gotta get together. Okay? Easier said than done. Number two, that we need to sharpen our spears. We need to have some weapons. And the weapon is your vote. That's not easier said than done. That's almost impossible. But now you're telling people that understand their history, and you're talking to people that know what happened. Our generation, we didn't know what happened. When we were doing Kahoolawe, we didn't know there was an overthrow. That's how well the colonization was done. We took our educational system, and put things in there and left things out. So this generation that we're dealing with now, especially on Mauna, is a generation that went to charter schools, schools that taught them about their culture, about their history, about their language, all the way through up through the University of Hawaii system where they got the degrees and the doctorates. These are the leaders that are out there now. These are the leaders that are leading us as Hawaiians with Mauna Kea. And they have caught the fancy, they have caught the vision of the Hawaiian people. The Hawaiian people are now having something that has to do with truth and honor. And they're coming together. They're not separating and fighting with each other like the media is saying. Mauna Kea is bringing Hawaiians together. It's becoming a common vision. And it's not a vision of Hawaiians versus telescopes. That is not what is happening on Mauna Kea. It's a unifying factor that only comes once, I don't know how often, if at all. So our politicians, including the Office of Foreign Affairs, they're misreading this whole thing of what's going on in the Hawaiian community. So we have the Hawaiians coming together, okay? On the other side of the fence, we have GMO guys. And we had like, I don't know, 2,000, 3,000 marching on the streets. And we were going, yeah, we got organized. The problem is, the same problem we're having in the Hawaiian community. Most of them did not vote. So there's a missing element in all of this. And in the Hawaiian community, not only did they did not vote, but they cannot understand why you would go and enter into a system that is right. An illegal system that has been pushing you down, taking all of your resources, destroying all of your resources, and just getting richer and richer. They couldn't understand why you would participate in that system. So now we have a vision as Hawaiians. That vision is that one day, our nation is going to be back. It's always been there because of all of the studies and all of the papers and all of the laws that we found out have been broken. Now tells us as Hawaiians that we have a future. We just got to go get it. So while all of this is going on, the United States of America now is into, I think, this week they're going to be voting again on the TPP. And that's going to get us into a whole different level that is above America or Hawaii or anything like that. It's going to be more all of these world order guys. And we're going to have another layer that we have to deal with. And none of us feel safe in that layer. So that gives us another reason as Hawaiians to push for us to get the Hawaiian nation back, which is a neutral country, back again. So the problem is, we don't vote, and we're at the bottom, but we're organizing. So what we've been doing as Hawaiians is we've been spending all of our time figuring out how we're gonna keep organizing, and we're gonna start pushing this idea that even though we have an illegal country that is in our nation, we we're going to have to protect the resources that we have now, because it's all disappearing faster than we can say anything. So, we're going to have, for instance, on the end of this month, on the 27th, we're having a large concert. We expect 8,000 to 10,000 people to be at the show. And we think it's going to happen. And one of the things we're going to do there is we're going to have voter registration. And we're going to be talking about the importance of voting. After the concert, we expect to make some money out of the concert. We're going to go island to island to island with all of our entertainers. And we're going to do the same thing on every single island. We're going to organize every single island. And we're going to be getting not only voter registration, but we're going to have their contacts. So anytime we have to do something really quick, we're going to be able to contact people. So during the Kahoolawe days, we had the newspapers and the television. They were actually reporters back then, not guys who fill in the blanks.
That's right.
Two sides of the story, right. And no story whatsoever. We don't have those people here today.
That's right.
So now we have social media, which works even better. And we're getting to learn how to use social media. One of the things that have made us successful so far, like the shirt that I'm wearing, it's almost becoming a brand already. And it's done by the young people. The young people that know how to talk to each other. He was a senator, and I bet you $10 that he didn't know how to talk to the young people. I don't know how to talk to the young people. They have the language all their own, and they wouldn't even listen anyway. So this whole generation of young people that have so much information, we now have the young people talking to themselves. And that's what's happening right now. So there's a lot of hope that this whole idea of coming together is going to work. So we need, what HAPA is doing is a more sophisticated way of organizing. It's part of the system. And the group that he's been able to get together is a very technical, well-chosen group of people that can operate and handle almost every problem that you can think of, I think. In fact, sometimes I'm sitting there after half a day and they're still going at it and analyzing it and turning it over and looking at all sides and all this kind of stuff. So I'm really glad that I'm part of this HAPA group that really understands how politics really operate. And I'm also part of the grassroots people. We know how to talk to each other and gather and come together. So for myself, the message that I would like to get out there is it's time for Hawaiians, and especially environmentalists, to come together under the banner of Aloha Aina. That's the common ground that joins both sides. And to try and convince the non-Hawaiians that you shouldn't be afraid of the Hawaiians. You shouldn't, because their goal is to make this a better place. They just want new tools to get there, and they want to use the tools of their ancestors that allowed them to live here for 2,000 years. Proven values that allow you to live on little islands in the middle of the Pacific. Proven values. They believe in those values. These young people believe in those values. They want those values to come back. They want those values to be the important values that allow us to make good decisions. So I'm going to, at this point, you know, throw a white net out there and allow you to know that we're trying to bring people together. And I can stand up here all night and talk about all the things that we're trying to change or protect and all those kinds of problems that we have. And there's all kinds of problems. We just need to find the ones that we all agree upon and come together. And I know this man and myself, we really believe that politics makes, especially in Hawaii, make things go or don't make things go. make things good or make things bad. And right now we're going in a really bad direction. Really bad direction. If we don't change, the small Oahu's gonna be the first one to feel the brunt. Because your spiral is a mean spiral. Some of the outside island guys, they got a chance to stop that spiral, but I don't know how you're gonna stop it here. I was in the freeway the other day, my God, I mean, you're gonna put all these houses and add more cars and put some cement thing that makes you think it's gonna solve all of this traffic problem when it's not gonna really do that. So I wanna open it up to questions, because you know where I was trying to go and I wanna know where you're trying to go, especially if you have questions about Mauna Kea and what's going on in the Hawaiian community, we can pick a couple questions.
Is the Hawaiian community as enthusiastic about protecting its traditional farmland in Ho'opili as they are in protecting the mountain?
Is that they are. They are, but it hasn't caught the imagination because nobody in Ho'opili got arrested. You know, it's still, you go to a hearing, you say your 3 minutes, go back, nobody listens to whatever you say, it doesn't make any difference. And they come up with a position that they knew they was gonna do before you had the hearing. It's a system that doesn't really get anybody excited except the hardcore guys that think they're gonna change the system, but it doesn't change. So it hasn't really caught on. But we all understand that in Hawaii, food security, self-sustainability was an integral part of our very being, because we didn't have any barges, we had to feed ourselves. So that's ingrained in us. So now we have a system where we don't have to feed ourselves. And that's where we're at right now.
This is traditional farmland for Hawaiians.
Yeah, I mean,
it's not only sustainability.
You need to talk louder so everybody else can hear.
Sorry, this is traditional farmland. It's your bread and butter for thousands of years. And is that going to catch on, and are people going to come out and stand up in the same kind of a way as this is our...
It's not going to be in the same kind of a way.
No.
Because it's going to be pretty close, but not quite the same enthusiasm. So what you got to do is, you got to have something that is going to bring everybody together, like Mauna Kea, and then you learn what it's going to, because it's almost an impossible battle right now. But it's not going to be built. It's not going to be built. So once we get that done, now you have the confidence to take on things that are in the system that you think the system is working when it's not working. And you're going to be able to get outside the system, and because you have unity and you have confidence, you can start solving many of those problems. So right now we got guys out in Nanakuri, I think, once a week or so.
Yeah,
Mondays. Every Monday. You see the signs, whole PV. You know, save our farmlands. It's out there. But it's not like
the state capital.
It's out there.
There's a group starting already.
Yeah, we just came from Lali Olani Palace, from the Hamas statue. Lancelot was with us. They're from noon today. We just came from there.
So, but is somebody still chained to this?
No.
Yeah. Okay, you have a question in the back?
Yeah, one question. How come with your career for a long time? And how about your reawakening in the animal world guys? And it seems to me, some of them talk about saying, before there were 1 million. Even before everything happened, there were 1 million Hawaiians living in this island, sustaining. And there were 1 million Hawaiians working mostly in the roads and in the beach. We have lost all that. We should go back to that.
Yeah.
But and, you know, I understand I'm originally from Costa Rica, and, you know, what happened in Costa Rica, what happened in Hawaii, what happened in Texas, what happened in the world, all the different places. OK, pretty much certain ethnic group came over and took over. And then pretty much destroyed everything that it was there before, because we were savages and they knew better and they knew how to produce, you know, richness, and they knew that the concept of land plot, which we didn't have it. The Native Americans didn't have it in America, the Hawaiians didn't have it. The land plot in America. How can you be the owner of a piece of that? And I'm saying all this because I'm a marine biologist, and you know, when I think about sustainability, and I think what I see right now is, as you said, a renaissance, and this is something that I know, a renaissance of the Hawaiian culture, Hawaiian language, in the younger generation. You know, we used to think, they used to say, characterize millennials as, you know, lazy. They want to, they don't want to work, they want to stay, you know, at home. And I have 1 hour talking to them, teaching to them, and this is not true. Some of them are even more conscious than our
generation. So what's your question?
Okay. Any other question? How many of you coming to the local year next Saturday to help clean it? How many of you coming to Haleiwa, to our fish pond, to help clean it?
When?
Sustainability, eh? The 28th.
Saturday.
7:30 in the morning, 8 o'clock.
Saturday.
Haleiwa.
Please.
Oh, Sunday.
How many of you? Yeah, like, talk about sustainability. Now, my question is, how many of you coming to help us clean the fish pond? Because that's sustainability. That is part of GMO. That is part of our people's culture. That is part of putting this back together to show them that we are serious about saving our land and not poisoning our lo'i, where we raise our fish, our lo'i, where we raise our kalo, our local ears, where we raise our fish. Please, come and help us. And please, tell them, come here, man, hey, sent you there. I won't be there because I'll be in Hawaii Island celebrating my family reunion. But please, go in my name, please, to support me and my people, our people, the Hawaiians. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
He brings up a really good point. Let me just expand a little on that. Besides the concert that we're going to be having at the end of the month, you know, we are, I don't know, if you drive around, you're going to see people holding signs in little groups, and they're just doing it all on their own. Nobody's organizing anything. So what we decided to do was, instead of just holding signs, we're going to organize work days, and we call them Aloha Aina projects. If we're just holding the signs, I mean, it's okay, and we're standing there waving and people waving back. But nothing gets built, we don't plant anything, we don't harvest anything. So we decided to do something useful. So the first project is going to be on Saturday, and it's going to start early in the morning, and we're expecting 1,000 people to come to the fish pond, and we're going to redo the walls of the fish pond at Kahana Bay.
Sunday.
It is Sunday.
This Sunday at Kahana Bay.
Next
Sunday. We're going to restore Pa'au fish pond from 7 to 12. That's our itinerary. Then from 12 to 3, we're going to head up to Kahana Valley. We're going to have Pa'ina, we're going to have Kukakuka and Talk Star. So from 7 to 12, we're going to rebuild Pa'au fish pond at Kahana Bay. And from 12 to 3, we'll have entertainment and may I, and we'll sit down and hold one of each other. So, you know, and then next Saturday, like Lincoln said, in Haleiwa, but this Sunday, Kahana.
Yeah.
So, how many of you guys coming out?
Please come.
Please come. Be there this Sunday. Sunday.
All right, and then next Sunday, we expect between 5,000 and we're hoping for 10,000. That's
That's going to be a prayer visual that's been organized by all of the hula halls in the state. So this is going to be something really big. And they're going to go to Waimanalo when the sun rises and do their prayers. And they're going to do prayers every hour on the hour until high noon. And then at high noon, there's going to be two motorcades, one going around Makapu and the other going to the tunnels. And they're all going to converge at the University of Hawaii to say the final prayer. So this is going to be a really big day. So we're starting off with making people work instead of just whole signs. We're now going to do the spiritual parts to connect the mountain with all of the different islands, with the prayer vigils. And then the following week is going to be the big concert of 8,000 people at the show. So the governor has a problem, and he's going to become a much bigger problem.
I am so aligned with what he is. His vision is that the answer to change is community action. You know, it's working in the community, it's holding signs, it's politics, it's all of us gathered together for a common purpose. And thank you for saying it so well. Thank you. Our next speaker is, before I do that, I want to recognize Nancy Alec from People's Fund. Nancy, raise your hand. The People's Fund does great work. If you're a small organization, you're a progressive organization, big or small, contact the People's Fund. If you're a donor, contact the People's Fund to support them with whatever you can give. I'd be remiss if I didn't say that HAPA also, any contributions, no matter how small or large, we need to do our work. And anyone that can hang around afterwards, I always forget this part, hang around afterwards to help us clean up, it's appreciated too, because what happens is the thing's over and there's one or two of us doing all the cleanup. So without further ado, I'm gonna bring up Kyle Smith. Kyle is an attorney, I mentioned earlier, who took on DuPont Pioneer defending the residents of Waimea Valley on Kauai. And, you know, where I live, you know, I'm not gonna be here on Sunday, I'm gonna be on Kauai, you know. But where I live, we have four of the largest chemical companies in the entire world operating in our community. Four of the largest chemical companies in the world, daily, spraying pesticides, growing test crops, you know, just in the Westside community, particularly surrounded by these crops. And this one community called out for help. They called out to Pioneer, DuPont Pioneer, something like 10 years ago, and said, you know, we're tired of you guys, your actions are impacting our community, and DuPont Pioneer did not step forward like the good neighbors they professed to be. And so this community did what you're forced to do. They went to talk to an attorney, a law firm. And when I first got involved in this issue about 2 years ago when I got back on the council, going around, people were concerned. People were concerned about their health. And I knew there was something going on, but when I heard a community in Waimea Town suing the major employer, I knew that there was something serious going on. This wasn't in Princeville, this is Waimea, this is a local community, plantation town, and they'd had enough. So they reached out to Kyle Smith, took on the biggest company, one of the biggest chemical companies in the world, and he won. Let's give it up for Kyle, please. Thank you.
Talk more into the microphone. Can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Is that a little better?
Yeah.
Closer?
Oh, there we go. Oh, you're really close. Okay. I'd like to say a couple different things, I guess. And first, for people that don't know about the lawsuit, I want to explain a little bit about that, because it's an important story, and it's important for all of the islands, and it's an example of how what we're doing tonight, why it can work and how it can work, and where it needs to go. But before I get to that, let me also talk a little bit about this group, which is a really new group, and why it's so important. I didn't know about the fish pond cleanup, right? How would I know? And I live here. I didn't know about several other things I've heard tonight. I don't know a lot of people in this room, and most people in this room don't know other people in the room, right? We need a big tent to hold it. And what I mean by that is we've got to have a tent large enough that we have different groups come together, that we've got environmental groups, which are really close to my heart, that we've got cultural groups, which are obviously so important for traditions. Uncle Walter, I met several years back when we started working out in Waimea, and he was a key part of that too, on coming out and giving people inspiration in Waimea. That it doesn't take millions of dollars to make a change. It takes a guy on a surfboard who paddles out and says, this isn't gonna happen anymore. Mm. And we've got a lot more than a guy on a surfboard in this room. We've got a whole hell of a lot more than that. But we don't know, we don't have that connection. And that's the genius, really, what Gary and the rest of people who are working with HAPA are doing. And so I didn't get a chance to say it last week. I want to tell you personally, thank you, because this is so important for what we do. Me personally, but more importantly, it's important for what everybody else in this room is doing. And it's really, really needed. And I hope everyone that isn't familiar with this group, I hope you start coming to the meetings and so that we can have a great time together. And we can learn about what all these other little groups are doing. And I'll tell you another thing, too, is that a couple of years back, when I first started, you might have guessed, I'm not from here originally, right? So I moved my family out to work in Waimea. I flew out, I had some experience on big cases, and I flew out and met with people in Waimea, and I sat down with a group a lot like this, just about the same amount of people in a school cafeteria, actually, I think, and I said, well, everybody's upset. You've been complaining. I understand. That's great. Everyone's upset. Yeah, chemical companies, poisoning people. So what? I think Jerry might have been there at that very first meeting. And what I told people there was that bad stuff happens every single day, and you can't do a dang thing about it. Why am I not? Bad stuff happens every single day. Until and unless you get a group together that works together. And this is more important here in the Hawaiian Islands, I found, than anywhere else, because the reality is, if you don't have groups working together, you're going to get splintered. And I tried to work in Waimea. Tried to say, hey, this GMO issue, or this chemical issue, or how we're dealing with farmlands, this is just a bunch of North Shore, beret-wearing pallies, right? This is just a bunch of North Shore, you know, they don't know what they're talking about. Or this is, you know, it goes the other way too, where it's, you don't know what you're talking about because you don't have experience and because where you grew up in Waimanala or whatever, that you don't have that kind of background. You don't have a PhD or you don't have this, you don't have that. That argument works both ways against every group in this community, every group in this room. And the beautiful thing about Waimea and why it's such a great model is that our trial, I had 86-year-old Japanese aunties who grew up in Jap Camp in Waimea. Father was a fisherman who drives her little red Jeep, who makes her own fishing lures, who lived through sugarcane and took the stand, flew over from Kauai, and took the stand and said, this is unlike anything that I ever experienced growing up. Now imagine that. It's worse than what sugarcane was at the worst days of sugarcane. That's how bad it is, right? Because you had that, her speaking. I had Native Hawaiians who were willing to come and explain why this was not part of their cultural values either. That's what it takes, particularly to win here on any issue. And what, again, just going back to why this group is so important, I'm sorry, guys. Someone just yell at me if you can't hear me. Why this group is so important is that I happen to be a lawyer. Being a lawyer is a lot like being a hammer. You know, every problem you see is a nail, right? But we're not the right solution for a lot of different issues, right? So you gotta have other tools in the arsenal. I was thankful and really blessed that I got to work with so many people on Waimea, and that fight goes on. I also recognize, though, that what I do is not the right tool for everyone or every problem. There's a lot of other kinds of tools in this room that are so important. And whether it's cultural issues on any island, whether it's environmental issues, whether it's educational, whether it's any progressive issue, it takes all those different tools. And the beauty of this group, hopefully, is it helps pick the right tools and the right teams to fix some things now. And why it's so nice for Uncle Walter to say, hey, we're not going to just wave signs, we're going to go try to fix things, even little things. And the thing I emphasized at the last time in Waimea through all these meetings, but also just last week, is that what really changed things in Waimea is that every single meeting, we had exactly this. We had the whole community come together, we'd hang out, have a meeting, we'd talk and explain how it's going, and things didn't go, we didn't win everything. We took some lumps in this trial, we took some lumps through the 5 years and longer that we've been working on it. But we did it together, and we explained, and everyone came down, and then we'd go sit down and eat, and in everyone's homes. It's such an important collective action that needs to start tonight, and it needs to be at the next meeting where you invite your family or your friends to come and sit and listen about how do we all work on different issues. So that's my plug, I guess, for HAPA a little bit. Let me tell you just a little bit about Waimea. As Gary mentioned, if you haven't been to Waimea, it's an incredible town, but it's in the middle of the southwest coast of Kauai. And 6 years ago or so, 5.5 years ago, when I first drove out there, flew in, was called in, and I drove out the southwest coast, it was thousands of acres, and it looked like it had just been plowed that day. Literally, as far as you can see on the highway going into Waimea and past, it was red dirt, openly plowed and left open. And I personally saw with my own eyes dust storms, tornadoes that were hundreds of feet high. And it was picking up that soil and just blowing out into the ocean. It was incredible. It was like out of the videos you see on YouTube of the Dust Bowl in Kansas and the Midwest. That's how bad it was for people who come from that part of the country. And this little community had people complaining to DuPont Pioneer for more than a decade. And this company had simply ignored them, had walked in and said, you know, we're sorry, a lot of lip service, but had done nothing to fix it and just left these fields open. And day after day, you can imagine Waimea's downwind, what that does when literally you wake up in the morning, you get in your sheets, and as you pick the sheets off of you, you see the cloud of dust. When you put your kids home and put them into bed, and you have to shake off, they literally take the plastic off the beds or take the sheet off the bed, and it's covered in dust. When you pull out, literally, these homes, every single plate and utensil in some cases are kept in plastic boxes to keep the dust off. It's incredible. I'm not even talking about the pesticides. People don't understand how many different types and how strong and how much and how frequent the pesticide use was going on these fields. And to some extent goes on today. I will say it's gotten a lot better since they got sued. And it's amazing how that works, right? When someone's actually looking and starts pointing a finger, it does get better. But if you look at the pesticide use, that historic pesticide use of using pesticides almost 250, 260, 270 days a year, plowing almost every day of the year, literally video and seeing pesticide drift into the community. Of all different kinds of pesticides, cocktails that have never been studied of how that works, at different kinds of levels. Imagine what you would think, sitting in that community for years, experiencing that, and how this community felt. So, they tried to complain, and they tried to complain, and finally they called us in, and we filed a lawsuit. And to make a very long story much shorter, we took it to trial earlier this year, and it was a 5-week trial in federal court here on Oahu. That's DuPont Pioneer didn't want to be in state court on Kauai, didn't want to have a Kauai jury, brings us to federal court on Oahu. We had a 5-week trial and a unanimous jury verdict in something like 12 hours, and it was just for the first 10 homes. And so there's many, many more homes still to go. I want to recognize, I'm looking at him right now, one of the people who is one of our really key witnesses, and it's Dr. Hector Valenzuela with the University of Hawaii. You should wave your hand, Hector, and stand up, because I'll tell you this much, you weren't at the last meeting, but there is, yeah. Again, I mean, lawyers are, we get called all kinds of things, right? we can get up and argue and tap dance and all that kind of stuff and do our best, and we can think very strongly about things are wrong, and I do think this is very wrong, but I can't win at trial unless I have people I represent who are, I believe in, and the jury believes in, and we have people like Dr. Valenzuela who willingly gave up so much time to help that community and got up and testified and explained why this was not right for Hawaii, why this was not right for agriculture on Hawaii. And we would not have won without you. First time I've actually got a chance to tell you that. I mean, one of the absolute most important things, and everybody in Waimea and everyone in this room and everyone in Hawaii, I think, owes you and should, I hope, thanks you and realize the important contribution you made. So we have, at this point, we have a unanimous jury verdict. It said a couple different things, and it said that this company, DuPont Pioneer, that the public benefit, what they claim to be the public benefit, that they pay a lot of money into the community. They have jobs, they create jobs, they spend a lot of money in the islands, right? What the jury said is that public benefit, tens of millions of dollars, Pioneer claimed, DuPont Pioneer claimed, does not outweigh the harm to that community. The harm to those 10 homes, just those 10 homes. Think about that for a second. A jury made up of people who live here made a decision in a federal court unanimously and said, these millions of dollars on one end of the scale do not justify what you are doing to our land and what you're doing to our people and what you're doing to this community that has one of the coolest histories in all of Hawaii. It's where Captain Cook first set foot. And I made that point. I said, it's somewhat interesting to me that this is where Captain Cook sits down in, I think it was 1774, 1778. 78, and then that sets off this chain of Western influence. And then, to put it mildly, and then later on, you now have this company, DuPont Pioneer, that literally is, in a lot of ways, a legacy of that first landfall. It's pretty heavy stuff that happened in Waimea, right? So that's why it's such an important thing in my mind, aside from the fact that the jury just ruled in our favor, or these other things that are going on. So it's a big victory, and it's still kind of sinking in. And what it's a victory that would not have been possible without a lot of people in this room. And that's what this night and that's what this group is about. And I talked to Walter right before this, but one of the things I want to understand better is understand these other issues better. And hope that we have a lot of other meetings like this where we can come together and say, hey, this is an important issue for this group, and here's why, and here's how you can help out, and this is an important issue for that group. And it puts us all into contact with each other. So thank you very much. If you guys have any questions, otherwise, I appreciate it very much. Yes? Pardon me? I guess you could call it a downwinders case, because they're on the downwind side of the trade winds. So yeah, for sure, trade winds blow across those fields and hit Waimea. But the important thing to remember is that, you know, we have Kona winds too, right? Pesticide drift, and importantly on this trial, it was just the drift of the dust, okay? That might have been in the papers, you may or may not have seen that. The jury didn't consider what harm the pesticides might be having. Pesticides drift the other way too, and the wind blows them the other way. And in fact, when the wind is not blowing, is some of the worst time, because that's when it really sits and expands out and hovers at a higher concentration in a given area. So it doesn't go as far, but the concentrations are worse. So that's one of these issues why the school buffer zones, when you're talking about just moving the stuff back a few hundred feet, seems to make perfect sense. That's why that's important. Yes, sir.
These corporations have appealed voter referendums and ordinances. What is the status? Are they going to pay up, or are they appealing, or what is the status of the case?
Sure. So there will be an appeal. You know, what we won in terms of monetary value is not that much, really, by their standards, and it's pretty cheap to appeal. So sure, they'll appeal. We just got a decision from the federal judge here that said they can't appeal. So if you think about the way the case was done is the whole group brought one lawsuit, everybody together, everyone on the caption, and we just tried one slice of the pie. And that was something that DuPont wanted, right? Because they wanted to take a bite and see if they win or not, and then go and appeal. And what happened is they lost, they don't like the taste, they now want to appeal, but the judge did rule in our favor on that and say, you can't appeal, we're going to figure out the rest of the pie. We're going to first take care of all those other homes in Waimea, and at that point, then you can take your appeal. So that's a process that is ongoing, and who knows how it works out. And the case may settle, or it might go up on appeal, there might be more trials. We're trying to figure that out right now. Yes, ma'am. So you need to, that's an, yeah, so the question was, what's the objective of the lawsuit? Would it surprise you if I told you that when I bring a lawsuit that involves almost 150 homes and almost 200 people on the caption, and they represent maybe 600-700 people all together, that they all have different objectives, that they have different opinions about what they want? I would say a substantial majority of my clients want them just to go now, because they've suffered through this for more than a decade, and they don't see it. Even those who don't have a problem with GMO, because believe it or not, within my community of people I represent, some people are very hostile to GMO just because it's GMO. And some people on the other end of the spectrum say, well, you know, we're not really sure about this, right? We're not sure exactly. Yeah, we're not sure if it's safe, we're not sure if it's dangerous, brings jobs, right? So that's, and you can have that dialogue, and we've had that dialogue in the case. I tell you this much, any single person in this room that wants to go down to Waimea, you contact me and I'll put you in contact with someone there, and we'll take a walk in that community and then see what you think about GMOs. Because who cares if it's safe on your plate, given what they're doing in Hawaii? That's the reality in my mind. Reasonable minds can disagree whether it's safe to eat, but the disdain that these companies have had for Hawaii, and Waimea in particular, because that's what I'm most familiar with, absolutely not. I've got no respect for these companies. Absolutely zero for the way that they've treated the land, what they've done in that community, what they've done in other communities, not just Waimea. So, anybody else, other questions?
I have a question.
Oh, I'm sorry.
My question is actually Mr. Hooser.
Sure.
Gary, but a policy maker, and I applaud you, Gary, for standing up for your people in Kauai, but my question is, we should have tougher laws against, you know, people, policymakers, as well as companies or lobbyists, you know, that they come together and they make this possible. We need to have stricter laws so that they know, without a doubt, if they're going to mess with the people, then they're going to pay. So for policymakers as well, we need really strict laws so that they know before they come and make business in Hawaii that they got this to deal with, because obviously they don't care. But if they have stricter laws that say, okay, if you guys come and do business and you're doing heaven, then you're going to pay. So that's my one now.
I'll go ahead and respond, but let's thank Kyle for all of this. And as Kyle spoke at the end, I was just going right on, dude, you know? I mean, I share his passion and anger, if you would, at the way these companies are treating our communities around the state. I mean, I live it every day where I live, but I know it's happening in lots of other communities. And I'm here today, it's a good question, I'm here today because government's not doing a fraction of what they need to do. That's why I'm here, not as a county council member, but as a private person working on a board of directors for HAPA, working with the community, because it's good. It takes community pushing and educating policymakers to do the right thing. I served 8 years in the Hawaii State Senate, and I'm just appalled at how the legislature now is treating the community and blowing off legitimate issues like pesticide regulation. On Kauai, we asked at the end of the day, just tell us what you're using. Just tell us the chemicals you're spraying and don't do it next to schools, houses, and hospitals. And we can't get that passed. What's up with that? Yeah. You know, so I'm with you. We need to make strong laws. They're here. These companies are here in our state because our laws are not strong. They talk about highly regulated. Well, that's Shibai. They're not highly regulated. On paper, they look like it. There's no accountability at all. No accountability. The Department of Ag does an inspection. It takes them years to close the account. They may inspect these companies four, five, six times a year. We need to do much more, but we need the community from all walks of life pulling together, not just for these companies, but for the corporate abuse that we're taking on many, many levels. I'm over it. You know, I'm thank you. We all should be. We all should be over it. And on a positive note, we live in a community that's small enough where we can make a difference. I mean, we could, you know, you could live in California or New York or something, and it's just, we live in a community where you can know your policymakers, you can know your state senator, your representative, you can go up and tell them directly. And so that's, we're fortunate, so we should take advantage of that. You know, as a community, you know, we should engage politicians and policymakers even more than we already have. So thank you for that question. I'm gonna take one more question, then I'm gonna move on with the program and take questions after. Yes, sir.
Gary, it goes without saying that you're not the only policymaker who's highly intelligent in all the legislatures throughout the islands. I wonder if you can articulate for us how you would approach those legislators who are aware of what's going on and recognize that it's not a good thing, and yet are unwilling to act against these things. How do we influence them? Because if we can influence them, then we can make the most immediate change. I would imagine, this is my perception.
That's a very good question. People ask me sometimes, they refer to different politicians and say, well, they're corrupt because they're not supporting our position. And I don't think it's, some of them are corrupt, but most of them just haven't been reached in their brain. And part of it is we have to be willing to come out and talk to them. When I say come out, I mean be willing to say, I'm concerned about GMOs, I'm concerned about pesticides. Because what happens is that so many movements, look at the history of any social movement. It's the radicals that are out front. The purple mohawks are out front. You know, the people holding the signs and yelling and getting in people's faces. And many of these policymakers, they pull back from those. You know, they what's going on? So the more people who are teachers and doctors and just carpenters, just regular people in the street, calling your representative or meeting with them personally and say, I'm concerned and I hope you help me on this. You know, how many people here know who their state senator is? No, okay, that's good. Most people don't. And so again, that's the most important. Again, I spent 15 years now in elective office. Okay, I love what I do. I can't do it unless I get elected. Okay, it's a number one rule. You can't serve unless you get elected. So the person who is most sensitive to you is the person who represents you in your district. Your council member, your house member, and your senator. You should develop relationships with them. Give them the information and be relentless in that. That would be my suggestion. They're surrounded, because I worked in that building for 8 years. You're surrounded by institutions. If you want information on agriculture, who do you talk to? You talk to CTAR. CTAR's drank the Kool-Aid on industrial agriculture. You know, who else do you talk to? The Department of Agriculture, the Farm Bureau. They talk to the institutions who big industry has already taken over. And so we have to fight a little bit harder to get through that. And there's a price to pay when you do that. You know, Hector was paid a big price at CTAR at the University of Hawaii from people pounding on him, how come you're causing trouble? How come you don't just shut up and get in line like everybody else? And he didn't do that. But he did a price to pay. It's a political price to pay for myself and others who stand up and talk like this. But the more of us that stand up, the more empowered other people are to stand up. So that's it. So I get a little bit excited about this. Thank you. There's a lot of people working on this issue. There's a lot of misinformation, a lot of information from Cal Smith's lawsuit we've used on other areas because of the discovery process. They get some information out of the files, it's public information. talked about spraying 220 days a year. 220 days a year on cocktails, pesticide cocktails that we can only dream of. You know, the little bit of information that I've gotten, there's at least 22 different restricted use pesticides, specifically over 18 tons a year on Kauai. And that's just one company here, 220 days. There's four companies. They're all doing it a lot, not even to talk about glyphosate. So I'm going to move into the Switzerland and keep this dialogue going because I know everybody has others. Yes?
I'm sorry, Gary, but who allowed these four companies to come inside Hawaii?
There is no law to prevent these companies from coming in. The question is, who allowed them?
Yeah.
They're treated, and on the council, myself and a few of my colleagues have tried to change that. But they're treated like every other farmer, and I'm saying they're not every other farmer. They don't sell any food. They don't produce any food.
That's right.
You know, they produce cattle feed, they produce ethanol, they produce high fructose corn syrup. They don't pay taxes on that, they don't sell it. I can go on, but we tried to at the council level, to create a different classification to have them be a higher level, but we were not able to do that. We don't even get the votes. And that's it. It's about getting the votes. It's about getting more people elected. So I'm going to transition quickly to, not quickly, but to this story. On Kauai, we're in court now. Maui's in court. Hawaii County's in court. These companies are suing all of us because they don't want to follow our laws that we pass in the democratic process. So we're a couple of months ago now, I got an email from a fellow in Switzerland who said, I heard about Kauai and you on the radio in Switzerland. And I'm just like blown away. How did you hear about us in Switzerland? And Swiss Public Radio had come and interviewed myself and others and reported on this. And so he basically said their group, MultiWatch, which we'll show you in a second, they're organizing a conference, and did myself, do I want to come talk to their conference? And I quickly thought about, yeah, let's do it. You know, if we can raise the money, pay the airfare, and pay all the expenses. And so I put together a small group, myself, Malia Chan, who's a cultural Hawaiian educator at Kauai Community College, who lives across the street from Syngenta's Fields, a young woman named Fern Rosenstiel, who was part of the movement on Kauai. And so we went to Basel, Switzerland. Syngenta is based in Switzerland. That's the hometown. We call it into the belly of the beast. That's where they're based. They're a Swiss company, and they're around the world. And so this is our delegation in front of the Syngenta headquarters. This picture is before the Syngenta shareholder meeting. So after the gentleman said, do you want to speak at our conference? I said, yes, let's do it. And he said, by the way, Syngenta is having their annual shareholders meeting, about 400 meters from our meeting. Would you like to speak inside that shareholders meeting? And I said, you can do that? I said, how do you do that? How do you get me inside the shareholders meeting to speak to 1,000 shareholders? And he said, we own one share of Syngenta stock, and we'll transfer it into your name. And so that's what happened. This is me going into the hall before the shareholder meeting started. So we can go ahead to the next slide. MultiWatch is the name of the organization that invited us. Fabulous group of people, that young and old, the older, more experienced people, had made their bones, I would say, shut down nuclear power plants 40 years ago. The young environmentalists, there were labor union people, and their mission, MultiWatch's mission, is monitoring transnational corporations based in Switzerland that are bad actors around the world. Companies like Syngenta. Companies that are based there, but yet doing things all around the world that they would never do in their hometown, and that people in their hometown don't know about it. So next slide. So this is us arriving. It's a beautiful country. The weather was beautiful. We raised the money in the community. HAPA stepped up with some money. Other people in the community stepped up, and the three of us were able to go. And we had we had some panel discussions. There were people from Paraguay there, people from Pakistan, labor people from Pakistan who had been shut out of their jobs, labor organizers who had been, their jobs had just been eliminated overnight. They come to work, you don't have a job anymore because it's not there. And all because they were organizing their workers, Syngenta's workers. A guy from Paraguay who also was there to talk about environmental impacts in Paraguay. It was a man from Holland talking about, he's a he has an institute in Washington, D.C. He's won a lot of very prestigious prizes in education and agriculture. Talked about The answer to feeding the world is not industrial agriculture. The answer to feeding the world is agriculture, small agriculture, located in the areas where the food is eaten. And another thought, I never forget this part. He said it's all about money. We know that instinctively. But he said a 99-cent value meal is not 99 cents. It's $3.99 because you've got obesity, you've got diabetes, you've got heart disease, you've got all these other, climate change, all these other impacts. So we might as well pay the price up front for that food and pay the $3.99 and be healthy. But it was an educational experience. We had other speakers. Next slide. Okay, this is ourselves. This is our host from Switzerland. This is from Pakistan. And that's us standing in front of the Syngenta. That was our field trips. We did touring. We went like vacationers where we did pesticides and toxic waste dumps, actually. Next slide. We met the politicians. This is part of the National Council. And this man was fabulous. He spent about 2 hours with us. And he couldn't believe what was going on. That they don't understand. When I was talking about disclosure, he says, "What do you mean disclosure?" I said, "So we know if they're going to spray next week to whether to avoid the area or shut our windows." He said, "You have to pass a law so you know when to shut your windows when they're going to spray these poisons." He was blown away by this whole thing. And part of the trip, and he didn't know this either, and a lot of people don't know, in Switzerland, GMOs are banned. You cannot grow something, and you can't eat GMOs in Switzerland. But you also can't use atrazine, paraquat, and four others, pesticides. Syngenta is a distributor of atrazine and a user of atrazine, and over 66,000 pounds of atrazine is used in our state. 66,000 pounds of atrazine is used here. It's against the law to use it in Switzerland. Okay, paraquat, they use it here. It's banned in 36 countries, including the country where this company is based. And this guy didn't know that, and it blew him away. It's just people don't get it. Next slide. He ended up actually writing a press release supporting our cause that was printed in the local paper. Next. This is a translation. We had a lot of attention. Talk about tools. We have a legal tool, we have community tools, we have law, passing laws, but we also have, I think the most important tool is shining a light on what these guys are doing. Shining a light, educating people, and we shined a big, giant light there. The media was reporting on us. We have a very compelling story to tell, the Hawaii story, the Kauai story, and we told it over and over again. Next slide. We met with this is in the Parliament of Basel. Again, very supportive. They ended up they tried to pass a resolution and only lost, I think, by 2 votes. But it's pretty cool, right? Switzerland's Parliament in Basel is discussing resolutions dealing with Hawaii and Syngenta and Kauai. And it's just really cool. Actually. Okay, this is one of our field trips. This is the Rhine, the river here. And along the Rhine are giant warehouses that are sealed up, that are toxic waste dumps. They don't know what to do with it because they had the problem before. Syngenta and other companies released atrazine into the Rhine when it was legal before. They dug up all the soil and it's sitting in warehouses along the Rhine. It was an interesting story. BASF has also got a headquarters there. It's a German company, I believe. Next slide. Okay, this is some of the media. These guys marched in one of our marches that Povolta was talking about. They never thought their picture would show up in the 3 daily newspapers in 3 cities in Switzerland, but it did. We had French documentary filmmakers that are following us through the trip. They'll actually be on, they're on Kauai now doing reporting. So the world increasingly is finding out about what these companies are doing. Next slide. Here we travel to another town called Lucerne. The trains, what they say about Switzerland being on time and watches and everything is all very true. You know, you could a train would pull up, it's supposed to be there at 3:01, and you'd say at 3:01, train is there. When we caught this train, the train was late. It was like 15 minutes late, and we complained to our Swiss host here that the train was late. He was top bragging about the train's been on time, and he said, "No, it's a French train." And it was a French train. he doesn't, we didn't drive, we didn't get in the car the whole time we were there. We walked, buses, or on the train. These are, this is right in front of the Syngenta head. Oh, this is the largest labor union in Switzerland. We met with them talking about labor issues with these companies. Next slide. This is a group called ATTAC, A-T-T-A-C, Swiss. ATTAC, I believe, is similar to the Occupy organization. It's very active in Switzerland. And we told our story there. The story we told, there's three of us. Malia Chung opened the, we had a kind of a formula. Malia Chung opened the discussion with historical cultural context. She talked about Hawaii feeding itself in the old days, you know, with the system, before all these guys got there. She talked about kuleana. She talked about values, Hawaiian values. And then Fern Rosenstiel talked about the pesticides. She's a science major. And then I would talk about the law breaking. And then we move on. Next slide. We had a petition that we launched. We launched it kind of late. We didn't want Syngenta to know that we were coming too early because we were afraid they would shut us down. And so we launched the petition late, but we still had over 7,000 signatures that we presented to both the government there as well as Syngenta itself. This is the day of the shareholders meeting. It's cold and it's raining and we're there, and all these people here are friends of ours in Switzerland who stood out in the cold and the rain to hold our banners and support our community. And we were just in this chicken skin moment. These people show up to help us and holding the banners. This young woman here is working on her master's degree, and she's focusing on the issue here. She'll be coming here in a couple of weeks. And so this is before I went in to speak. Next slide. And so when I went in, I had been coached, if you would, by others who had done similar projects in the past. They said, Gary, you know, you gotta be strong, and you have to ask for something that's part of the rule. You have to address something on the agenda, and you don't know if they're gonna shut you down, you don't know if they're gonna turn the mic off, you don't know if they're gonna boo you, you don't know how much time you have. And there's about 950, just short of 1,000 people in the audience, shareholders. And the board is sitting at the top. And so I went up to speak, and Fern was there with me. Fern, she carried a camera in. And to be clear, there were no signs that said, no cameras, no signs said that. But they kept the media out. The French guys wanted to come in, the local television, they didn't let any media in. Fern did bring a camera in, and she had it. And when I started to speak, she started to film. And so it comes, and the film is in two segments. And we'll show you the first segment. Security came up to her and told her to stop filming. And so she did, she stopped filming. Then they came back and said, I want your camera. And she says, I'm not giving you my camera. And they made her leave, and as she walked away, she turned the camera on again. And so it's in two segments. Are we ready to go?
I don't know if it's gonna work.
Okay, we'll try it. It was working a few minutes ago. So I spoke, and I had to speak on something on the agenda. Well, you want me to try to find the connection?
Or do a refresh on the YouTube page.
So I was told to find something on the agenda, so I chose the annual report. You know, it's got treasury report, et cetera, annual report. So I did the annual report, and I said with my remarks that I want to tell you something. It should be on your annual report, but it's not. And then I made my ask. And the ask that I made was, I'm asking the shareholders and the board of directors of Syngenta to withdraw the lawsuit against the county of Kauai, to honor our laws, and give us the same protections and respect they give the people in the local community. That was my ask. And the people in the audience, thank you. The people in the audience clapped also. It was really amazing. At the end, I think they got it. They understood that this was coming from my heart, and our community is being treated disrespectfully, and they can do something about it. So because I didn't know how long I was going to be able to speak, I made the ask first in case they pulled my plug. And then I asked them, I said, imagine if your community, if you drove around every day taking your kids to school, going to work, and you're driving by GE test fields every day. And you smell stuff, and you wonder what's going on, and you don't know, and people in your neighborhoods are saying, well, you know, I'm getting headaches, kids are getting sick in school. Sea urchins, 30,000 sea urchins died off Kauai's coast. Nobody knows why. So what if that was in your town? What would you do? What would you do? You would ask your government for help, right? That's what they would do in Switzerland. That's what we do here in Hawaii. What happens? They ask our government for help. We step up, we help them, and the company sues us. And so the people, again, they understand that. What if this happened where you lived? They got it. And Fern left. Well, we've got a video that's very short. We've got a couple of them, actually. So I'm going to, while they work on the video, I'm just going to summarize that. So I spoke, we left, and then the media is still going. I say, you know, Switzerland Syngenta is the political action that just keeps on giving. We have a week or two after we left, there was, well, whatever the March Against Monsanto dates, okay, the March Against Monsanto was a certain day. In Basel, Switzerland, they had never marched before, and they marched then and carried Syngenta, it was March Against Syngenta and Monsanto, but they carried the Shame on You banner, our banner, down the streets of Basel with over 1,000 people marching, and it was just incredible. So you think these people on the other side of the earth, literally on the other side of the earth, helping us out. It continues to get media over there. The company, people ask me, well, what did they say? What did the company say? So I spoke, and I was told that after I speak, they're going to respond. So I spoke, and then the chairman of the board and the chief executive officer responded to me. They'd already known basically what I was going to say, because before you speak, you have to sign up, and they have to tell them what your ask is. So they knew that all right away. The CEO of Syngenta is an American, just for what it's worth, is an American. The chief operating officer, I think, is a Belgian. But they said, thank you, Mr. Hooser, for being here today. We understand your concerns. And we want everyone to know that we're good citizens of Kauai, and we follow all the laws, and we only spray pesticides on our lands. And I said, thank you very much. And I'd just like to clarify something, that yes, you spray them on your lands, but you spray them on your lands adjacent to schools, hospitals, and homes in my community, and you're not allowed to do that in your own community. And they said, thank you, you're done. And I left. There were other speakers there speaking on labor issues and other environmental issues. Okay, I think we're going to do it.
I greatly appreciate the opportunity to speak today. My name is Gary Hooser. I'm from the island of Kauai in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. I presently serve on the Kauai County Council. I'm a lawmaker, a resident of Kauai for 40 years. Formerly served in the Hawaii State Senate. I was a senator there and director of the Office of Environmental Quality and Control for the state of Hawaii. I'm here today to add information that perhaps is not contained within your annual report. And I appreciate your patience with me allowing me to share the message from my community in Kauai. I'm also here today to present a petition from thousands of residents of our small island. There's only 60, 65,000 people live where I live. And we are very, very concerned about our community and the impacts that Syngenta has in our small community. And that petition is very simple. It asks Syngenta to honor the laws of our community. Withdraw your lawsuit from the courts of Hawaii, and to give us the same respect, the same protection that you give the people of Switzerland. Right now, Syngenta sprays enormous amounts of atrazine in the fields around homes, schools, and hospitals where we live. Atrazine is not allowed to be sprayed in your country. Syngenta sprays enormous amounts of lies of paraquat, which is banned here in 36 countries around the world. And you do it daily in our community. There's four additional highly restricted chemicals that are sprayed daily around schools, hospitals, and homes where I live. Imagine if you had to drive and live in a community surrounded by GE test fields, and every day you know that they're spraying toxic chemicals in the areas around where you live. Imagine if the schools in your community had children getting sick like they do in my community, and going to the hospital in ambulances, throwing up, while Syngenta is spraying fumes right next door. Imagine if the doctors in your community, like the doctors in my community, are concerned about birth defects.
I don't understand.
We believe that there is 10 times the rate, the national rate of birth defects in a small hospital where I will
stop filming.
And they don't.
So that's when the security leader turned the camera off at that point. And then the security comes back to her just moments later and asked for the camera. Is this the next one? Okay, and then she proceeds to leave, but she turns the camera back on again.
Local laws. That is not true. That is an untrue statement. Syngenta has not complied with our laws. Syngenta has chosen to take us to court. Syngenta has not complied with our property tax laws. Syngenta has not complied with our grading and growing laws. And they continue to misrepresent their position to me as a council member, to my community, and to you. So again, I'm asking you with great respect, withdraw the lawsuit from the county of Kauai. Honor and comply with our laws, and treat us with the same respect, the same dignity, and the same protections that you give the people of Switzerland. Do not spray chemicals in my community that you cannot spray in your own community. Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak. Aloha.
It's really kind of fascinating. This is you don't need to watch this movie. That's the 4-minute video we took to close it up. But it is surreal. I mean, this experience, as they're giving their annual report, you have fields of corn and grain and all these flowers and the music, and it's just all so pastoral. And then they're putting up graphs and charts predicting their income for the coming year. And it's all based on chemical pesticide sales, all of it. They have little asterisks. If we only get this one approved by the United States, we're going to make another $100 million next year. If we only get this one approved by these countries. But yet, it's superimposed on these really wholesome, it's really, really strange. Outside in the lobby area was a fabulous buffet and wine, and let the record reflect, I did not eat anything at all and left there. So I'll take a few questions before we do this video first. Maybe we'll do the video. Those of you, some of you may not all be familiar with the movement on this issue that's happening in Hawaii right now. As we went to preparing for Switzerland, Teresa Tico, who's an attorney on Kauai, who's been helping us a lot, she's also a filmmaker, we asked her to do this next video, which she did in about a week, and we were showing this everywhere we went through. So we'll watch this, we'll take some questions, and then we'll go from there. Go ahead.
Most people think of Hawaii as paradise, but Hawaii is also ground zero for the research and development of genetically engineered seeds. 5 of the largest multinational chemical corporations in the world, Dow, Syngenta, DuPont Pioneer, Monsanto, and BASF, are all using Hawaii to develop seeds that are genetically engineered to withstand higher and higher levels of pesticides. Over 3,000 permits have been granted by the U.S. Department of Agriculture for field trials of GE crops on the tiny landmass of Hawaii, more than any other state in the nation. On Hawaii alone, these chemical companies purchased 18 tons of restricted-use pesticides per year from 2010 to 2012. A lawsuit has uncovered that DuPont Pioneer sprays pesticides approximately 250 days a year upwind of the residential community of Waimea, Kauai. These toxic chemicals have transformed parts of Hawaii into one of the most toxic chemical environments in American agriculture. Many residents are concerned about the public health and environmental impacts of this chemical use. School children and teachers near one of the fields have collapsed multiple times after smelling noxious odors. Residents near the test fields report high rates of congenital heart defects, 10 times the national average. When the state failed to protect the people from chemical company activities, Hawaii residents marched across the islands. Counties began epic battles to pass laws that would protect their residents. After a historic battle, Kauai County passed Bill 2491, a law that created modest buffer zones around schools, streams, and other sensitive areas, and required disclosure of pesticide use by large users of restricted-use pesticides. On Hawaii Island, the County Council passed Bill 113, which banned all new GE crops. And in the November election of 2014, the voters of Maui County passed a moratorium on all GE crop operations until a health and environmental impact study is done. But rather than comply with these laws, the chemical companies brought lawsuits to fight every one of them. In August 2014, a federal magistrate judge ruled that only the state can pass these types of pesticide protections. That decision is being appealed. With county legislation tied up in the courts, Hawaii residents are back to fighting at the state level. Several bills introduced in the 2015 legislative session would have created pesticide buffer zones and required disclosure of pesticide use by large users, but these bills were killed. The fight continues, but we need your help.
For stepping up with his technical assistance to get the videos going. You know, this experience, I mean, I wasn't going to give the speech, but it wouldn't happen without a whole bunch of people. I'll tell you that right now. And that's how we're going to win in the end and take back our government and take back our communities with everybody playing a role. And on Kauai, there were people literally sleeping on the sidewalks to testify at the hearing, you know, because they didn't want to get squeezed out because the chemical companies were busting in their people. The chemical companies were hiring homeless, down and out drug addicts to hold their place in line. And I know it for a fact because I was there. And our people, young people, old people, were out there in the rain, sleeping on the sidewalks so they could get in. And that's the kind of commitment and dedication, unfortunately, that it takes to do some of this stuff. But there's all different roles people can play. You don't all have to sleep in the rain. You know, you can write letters, you can come to meetings, you can talk to your neighbors. But really, the winning is about engaging our community and believing. Okay, you gotta believe, first of all, you gotta believe we can win. Some people don't believe we can win, and so they stay home. Okay, I'm not, you know, Paul Ashitoff was on board. He said, Gary, you might as well give them the keys. I mean, if that's how you believe, let's just give these guys the keys and then we just forget it. And I don't believe that way. And I don't want to really, many people, most of in this room, I don't think believe that. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here. So I'm going to take some questions and then we can, you know, go from there. Questions? Yes.
I know you talked to a lot of different kinds of groups while you were over there, but did you have any them, and have any of the shareholders contacted you since the meeting?
So the question is, we talked to a lot of groups. Was there any action or any ask that we made of them, and if shareholders contacted us? There has been some action. They holding our banner in their march was one significant one. That has gotten more airplay than anything that we posted so far. It's just got a whole lot. They've also written letters to the paper, letters to the editor type of things. And they went, after we left, this group, MultiWatch, went to meet with the government of Basel formally and presented our case to them again. And so it's an ongoing, they're there and they're motivated there. Just acknowledging, number one, acknowledging the situation and asking Syngenta to honor and respect our, to do what I asked, basically. And again, they actually hit the floor of their parliament and lost by, I think it was 42 to 45 or something. But yes, a lot has happened. And it continues to happen. As a result of this, we're looking at, when I say we, HAPA and others, are looking at the possibility of doing an international conference of our own here in Hawaii, and go from island to island and bring in people from Asia, from Africa, from South America, other groups, because it's not just about other people getting impacted, it's about working with them towards this common goal. And that was one thing Malia Chan would close our talks about, and it was spontaneous, and then she kept doing it, that it's not about our backyard, it's about all of our backyards, and we're all responsible. And so that international communication and international dialogue, I think, is very important. I want to recognize Hawaii Seed also. Mary Lax is here. Thank you. Mary DiPietro. Thank you for here. Hawaii Seed. The GMO Free. These guys started talking about this and working in action on this a long time ago. Other questions?
Yes, Gary. My Manao in Switzerland, where you folks went, Syngenta, that's the headquarters are there?
Yes.
Okay, so they themselves got. They made the law that they don't spray in their country, right, in their land. So they got them passed. Now, they're doing that over here and all over the world. But why, if the people over there was so passionate about not hukai in their aina, but why are they not passionate with their own company making hukai in our aina? So get me thinking, like, isn't Syngenta paying off the, does the money that they make go back to the Switzerland public, right. You know, so to keep them, you know, passionate to say, okay, you know, that's my question, because if they're so passionate about them not making the crap in their land, but it's okay to crap in other people's land, you know, so that's my question.
The I'm not sure about the pesticide approvals of the ban. So they banned atrazine in Switzerland, so they're not allowed to do that. But I know the GMO ban was a ballot initiative. The people of Switzerland put it on the ballot and voted for it. It wasn't lawmakers. So it was the people. It's like the Maui one. You know, the people voted, and it's actually going to be coming up for another vote, I think, in 2 years, 2018. The politicians I talked to in Switzerland are not that much different from ours in some ways, because they said they recognize Switzerland's a big employer. I mean, Syngenta's a big employer there. They can only push so hard. They're not sure what they can do, but they'll try. I think a lot of it was just the awareness. They're not aware what Switzerland's doing. That's what MultiWatch, like that organization, is trying to do, trying to make their own countrymen aware of what Syngenta is trying to do. And that's what we did, big time we did it over there. So the community, once you hear that, once you hear, like you said, you know, they're peeing in the pool, these people's house over here, and they're not allowed to do it over here. People don't, you know, they're not comfortable with that. Other questions? Any other questions? Yes. Yes?
How did they get the, how did they get the vote on it? Did they have initiatives? Did they collect signatures and then they put it on the ballot?
Yes.
Well, Honolulu County does that.
Okay, so the question is, that's a very good point. So the Syngenta folks, not Syngenta, the Swiss population gathers signatures to ban genetic GMOs in their country. And they were successful getting the signatures, put on the ballot, and they voted on it. So Maui County did the same thing, and they're in court right now. The way the law works in the state of Hawaii, counties have the right to do that. Initiative, either change the charter or change the law by signatures. The state does not allow that. So in theory, the city and county of Honolulu, or Maui County, Kauai County, could gather signatures, just like you said, and change the law here. And I would argue that we should all think about that. You know, Maui did it, and it's in court right now. But there are other initiatives. Right now, the question of the ability of counties to ban GMOs or ban pesticides in court. So it probably doesn't warrant doing another ballot initiative until the courts decide. But there are other types of ballot initiatives that we might be able to do, dealing with farmland, dealing with the preservation of land, dealing with minimum wage. Our organization is looking at broad-based issues. And so across the nation right now, it's a little bit different from what we're talking about, is this national effort to raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour. That's being done by ballot initiatives in many places. And so that's a tool that the city and county, you folks, could use. And if anyone wants to talk about that later, I'd be happy to talk about that. And HAPA as an organization might be able to support someone. Other questions? Let me get someone who hasn't asked yet. Yes? Who in the legislature killed our bills? Without question, it was a State House Committee on Agriculture. Cliff Tsuji is the chair. But I'll have a caveat to that. Okay, I served for 8 years, and a lot of people like to point at, well, it's a speaker or it's Cliff. The majority makes a decision. So the majority of the body acquiesce to those committees. But the short answer would be the House Agricultural Committee. But if the leadership of the House wanted that bill to pass, it would pass. But they have this huge misinformation and disinformation campaign by the industry and by institutions in our own government. Syngenta, for example, repeatedly says atrazine is not banned in Switzerland. They say it to the media, they say it every day, they were rebutting me in our local paper, and if you care to see it, you can Google the New York Times, February, Syngenta, atrazine, and there's a whole article about how Syngenta's going around telling everybody it's not banned, but it is banned. So they keep saying this stuff. They'll say pesticides are safe. No one's getting sick. If you read the literature, just the basic literature, the American Cancer Institute, American Academy of Pediatrics, it's clear. You look at areas that have intensive agriculture, and intensive pesticide use have higher rates of a whole wide range of diseases and cancers and stuff. Doesn't mean you're going to be throwing up, but it means this impacts your health negatively. And it's about the difference between chronic and acute. Okay, it's about living across from the fields for 30 years and having small doses blown on you every single day and on pregnant women every single day. And they say, well, there's no proof, study it. Well, we can't study it without disclosure. Right? So they won't tell us, and so we're fighting. But yes, yes.
Oh. Based on your experience with Governor Ige, you've had some personal experience with him. Would you give us your perception of his receptivity to ideas such as the ones that you've enumerated tonight? And can you give us an idea, are there any legislators who you feel have a certain consciousness where they can receive this kind of information, as opposed to those legislators who were pretty close-minded?
Okay, Governor Ige, I've served with for 8 years, and I think he's an honest man. You know, I think he's a hardworking guy. He comes from a more conservative environment than I do. He's an engineer. No offense to any engineers in the room, but I think he's open on the pesticide issue. I think he's open to increasing regulations on that. If something got to the legislature, he would sign it. A lot of people push back from the word GMO. It's like it's too toxic, they don't want to talk about GMOs, whether it's, and Kyle mentioned it, it's not about, or me too, it's not about the eating it necessarily, it's about all the other impacts, the impacts on my community, global impacts on the food supply, you know, unintended consequences, you know, it's not about throwing up after you eat a Dorito. But, so I think he's our governor, and I think, you know, we've got a good shot with pesticide regulation anyway. And I think he's aware of the need, the political need, as well as the real need of expanding agriculture on all levels. Food sustainability, not just agriculture. food sustainability. On Kauai, the Agribusiness Development Corporation is a state, quasi-public-private state agency that manages state agricultural lands. Almost all their Kauai lands are leased to these four companies. So these are state lands, these are ceded lands, these are public lands that are turned over to these corporations who are doing this action. And just recently, the good news is, and they will say it's not because of the good work of Kyle or our community, but Pioneer has closed down some fields, and apparently there's about 3,000 acres that they will not be using. That's 3,000 acres that won't be spending pesticides on. Syngenta also has just cut loose, stepped away from over 500 acres. They do have much greater buffer zones than they did before, and it's kind of crazy. They'll say they're voluntarily complying. Yeah, after we hammer them and sleep on the sidewalk in front of the building, they're going to voluntarily comply. Yes?
What can
you're 16 and your teacher's telling you your votes don't count?
Like Hawaii votes don't count.
National. National. No, I would say absolutely not. Your teacher's got no business telling you that. I mean, I think your voice counts. Okay, your voice counts. Your voice counts probably more than most people in the room.
Yeah.
Yes, let's give it up. Your voice counts. Some of the most powerful testimony I've ever witnessed has been from young people like yourself. You know, we wouldn't have a bottle bill today, which takes a lot of bottles out of the trash, if not for the testimony of young people who came forward and said, why don't you do something for us in the future? You know, and so I encourage you to stay involved. Yes, and your voice does count. Yes. Personally,
I want to thank you for bringing awareness to the problems here on Kauai but I read an article that Monsanto was trying to buy Syngenta. So what happens if Monsanto acquires Syngenta?
What happens if Monsanto acquires Syngenta? Right now, Syngenta has the largest market share of pesticides, and Monsanto has the largest market share of G-test seeds. So if they merge, that would be a Godzilla, if you would. And Monsanto is trying to do that to improve their image. Because Monsanto is like the devil, right? So I don't know what's going to happen to that, but it'll make our work easier, I guess. We don't have to focus on two of them. You know, it's 7:30. I'll take a couple more questions, but I am actually flying back to Kauai tonight, and we have some cleanup. Yes.
Yeah. Do you think you did a great job there in Switzerland for this GMO movement? Do you think you can do that same job for our people, the Hawaiian people's movement in Washington, explaining to them what they are doing to our people, occupation,
thank
suppression,
you.
And oppression of Hawaiian people?
Thank you. The question is, I did a great job in Switzerland, can I go to Washington D.C. and help move forward the Hawaiian nation and explain to the people in Washington D.C.? And you know, I count on people like Walter Ritte and Ikaika Hussey and others who are involved in this movement to give me guidance. You know, I'm not from here, but I'll stand next to you and next to Walter and next to all of you and share whatever mana'o and whatever juice I got to help you guys. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Yes. Louder?
Yeah, you're both. You're both not counting. Gary's a good example. If he wasn't in office, we wouldn't be in charge of a lot of Hawaii. He is the main reason that we succeeded what we have, even across the state. So if that's a good example of why you've got to vote. We've got to get more guys like Gary in office.
Thank you.
Thank
you very much. Thank you. I want to say he's right. Okay, this last election, I won by 82 votes. 82 votes. And I'm not the end-all for politicians, but I love serving, and I think I'm doing a good job. Without those 82 votes, I would not be serving on the Kauai County Council. There's a lot of ways to serve, but I would not be able to have the position I have now. This gentleman over here had, yes, sir.
Yeah.
If you can, a short question, because we got to close up.
Do you think the TPP and the
request back from the more information, I'll come up from the DACA on Sunday. I'm aware of what we're here because we are not alone. This is something that we can come with a lot of business.
Thank you. The TPP is a key issue on this, and there's no time right now to discuss the whole thing, but it is a really, really bad news for the world. And so we need to all be aware of it. And I think most of our congressional people are on the right side of it, but we have to hold them hard to those positions. So thank you all very much for coming. You guys close up. Aloha.
Aloha. Thank you. That was the Oahu meeting for the Hawaii Alliance for Progressive Action.